Good morning, it's 9 o'clock on Sunday the 18th of September. Thank you for choosing to wake up with us.
Jakers, it's 9 o'clock already, lads. The morning's half gone. Coming up, winter warning as COVID and flu could see more than 20,000 admitted to hospital. That's at least what they're planning for. We'll have that story and everything else making today's paper shortly.
The rugby's back. Munster fell just short against Cardiff in the opening game of the United Rugby Championship yesterday. We'll be chatting sport just before 10.
And why are pronouns so important? We'll get a guide on how to use them correctly.
And if you're nervous about your best man's speech, well, we have advice on how to make sure you don't leave the mother of the bride red-faced.
What if you want to?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
What if that's the intention?
Yeah.
What if you want? I'm going to offend.
Well, we can help with that today as well.
We'll try that. Plus, the star of Philomena, the snapper, Moon Boy, Ballykiss Angel, Dame O'Niver, and of course, the award-winning, the Oscar-winning My Left Foot, Ruth McCabe, will be dropping by.
Yeah, good day yesterday after. What did you do?
I went to bed, actually.
You didn't go to Garth?
I didn't go. No, I was hoping. I went to Garth last Friday week, and I was saying for the entire week I'd love to go for his last gig. He did his last show last night.
Was there an encore?
At least on our show, he does a thing where he comes back on. He kind of goes off, and everyone's like, he's going to come back. And he comes back, and he does a few. I don't want to ruin it for anyone, but he does a few covers. Of like brilliant tunes.
He's
such a show. I don't care what you say. Don't be slagging off Garth to me. I'm Garth till I die. I bleed Garth. And I just want him to come back. That's
right,
all.
Let's check on the news you're waking up to today with Cliodhna Russell. Cliodhna.
Thanks, Paul. Good morning. A search operation is continuing in North Mayo this morning. It's understood a man got trapped in a sea cave yesterday evening. It happened in the Downpatrick Head area of County Mayo. Gardaí and emergency services remain at the scene and say the rescue operation is ongoing. A man in his 50s has died after being hit by a Lewis tram in Dublin in the early hours of this morning. Gardaí and emergency services were called to the scene at Broombridge in Cabra at around 1 a.m. A man later passed away from his injuries. Gardaí are appealing to any witnesses of this incident or road users who may have video footage to come forward. Both the President, Michael D. Higgins, and Taoiseach, Micheál Martin, will be in London for the state funeral of Britain's Queen Elizabeth, which will take place tomorrow morning. Tens of thousands of people have again queued overnight to pay their respects to the late monarch.
Braving the cold and the long wait, hundreds of thousands of people have continued to join the queues in London in recent days to pay their respects to their late monarch. Yesterday, Britain's new King Charles and his son Prince William paid a surprise visit to those waiting in line, meeting and greeting those who had been there for hours. Despite the lengthy wait, with queues stretching to 8 kilometres in places and overnight temperatures dropping, thousands more have been joining the queue in recent hours. Last night, the Queen's grandchildren paid tribute to the late monarch, standing for a vigil by her coffin. Today is the final full day of the four-day lying in state of Queen Elizabeth at Westminster Hall. The public will be permitted to queue overnight one last time before it ends at 6:30 in the morning. World leaders, including the US President Joe Biden, are gathering in London for the state funeral of the late British Queen, which takes place at Westminster Abbey tomorrow morning. Mourners have already started to camp out to secure vantage points for the funeral. President Michael D. Higgins and Taoiseach Micheál Martin are travelling to London to attend the funeral. Marie Mulcahy, Virgin Media News.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky says there's new evidence of torture by Russian forces. He said more than 10 torture chambers have been found across territories recently retaken from the Russians.
There are names on some graves, but many are only marked by a number. Exhumations are ongoing at the site of mass burial in the forest near Izium. The remains of more than 400 people, mostly civilians, were discovered after the city was recaptured by Ukrainian troops in its successful counteroffensive in the Kharkiv region. Ukraine's officials said almost all bodies had signs of violent death. A UN monitoring group is planning to visit the site, and the details of the atrocities are expected to be a key part of Zelensky's address to the United Nations next Wednesday. Reacting to the grim discovery in Izium, The Czech Republic, which currently holds the EU presidency, called for a special international tribunal to prosecute apparent Russia's war crimes. Tanya Royt, Virgin Media News.
Garth Brooks has promised Irish fans that he will be back, saying that playing here is all he wants to do. The singer held a press conference in Dublin last night ahead of his final concert in Croke Park. Our reporter Paul Quinn has the details.
Well, after a 25-year wait and 8 years since the 2014 five-in-a-row fiasco, Garth Brooks has wrapped up his five gigs here at Croke Park. Some 400,000 tickets were sold. Many came more than once. Some came to all five shows, while 20,000 tickets were sold to people overseas in some 30 different countries. Now, last night before the final show, Garth Brooks held a special press conference backstage here at Croke Park. He described the five gigs as emotional and promised fans that he'll definitely be back.
For me, the 8 years is the tip of the iceberg. For me, it's since 97. Because 97, something happened here in 97, I'm not sure you guys even know. But we got the call, damn it. We're here three nights. First night, I get the call that my mom's cancer is back. Yeah. And we were going to head on back. And Dad said, finish your job there. So I never really got to enjoy the thing there, right? And then you get ready to come back, especially after retirement, come back. Then that happens. So coming here, it's not just 2014. It's 97. It's everything. But I got to tell you, once you've tasted it, and we tasted it in 94 with Jim Aiken and The Point, once you taste it, you can't come back here quick enough.
Of course, these five gigs have also been a huge boost to the local economy. Dublin Chamber estimating that the five concerts have pumped an extra 35 million into the local economy, some 2,500 people working every night at these gigs. As I say, some 400,000 fans finally getting their chance to see Garth Brooks perform here at Croke Park. While he says that Dublin is the final stop on his last ever stadium tour, he has left the door open to returning to Ireland.
For car insurance, van insurance, or home insurance, call the Quote Devil. Unless, of course, you've got money to burn.
This morning, we can expect brief spells of mist with mostly dry conditions and a few isolated showers in northwest parts of the country. Temperatures will range between 9 and 13 degrees. The afternoon will then see mostly cloudy skies with more sunshine as we move through the day and temperatures ranging between 16 and 18 degrees. And tonight we'll see more cloudy conditions with some isolated showers and patches of fog across the country. Temperatures overnight will range between 7 and 12 degrees.
For first-time drivers, young drivers, returning drivers, if you've had an open claim or have had too many penalty points. The Quote Devil's always got one hell of a
quote. Now up next, from potential blackouts to COVID winter warnings, we chat through the top stories making today's papers after this. You're very welcome back to Ireland AM. Welcome to your Sunday, and let's check in on your Sunday papers. Starting with the front page of the Sunday Independent this morning, and they lead with revealed HSE's twindemic winter warning. They report that the HSE is bracing itself for one of the worst winters in years due to a predicted twindemic, they say, of coronavirus and flu outbreaks. The Business Post this morning opens with state aid scheme to provide new electricity grants of up to €500,000 for struggling firms. They write that the government is preparing a new scheme that will allow energy-intensive businesses to apply directly for grants to offset the soaring price of electricity. And the front page of the Sunday Times has Northern traders torn over closing for royal funeral. The paper claims that businesses in Northern Ireland, and in particular Derry, are divided over whether to shut their doors tomorrow for Queen Elizabeth's funeral. Now, onto the tabloids, and the Irish Mail on Sunday leads with serving soldiers claim sex assaults. They write that more than 100 witnesses have given evidence suggesting a culture of harassment in the Defence Forces, with at least two serving members having given testimony stating they were sexually assaulted while on duty. And the Irish Sunday Mirror opens with Gardaí face drug tests by Christmas. The paper reports that new Garda recruits are to face mandatory drug testing this year as part of a systemic crackdown on corruption. Over to the Sunday World, which leads on the Molls-Royce lifestyle. The Molls-Royce lifestyle. The paper describes the millionaire lifestyles enjoyed by Kinahan money launderer Johnny Morrissey and his wife prior to his recent arrest, with the pair having invited a lifestyle magazine into their home for an interview earlier this year. And finally, we have The Sun on Sunday. It opens with Garth, I'll Be Back. Shoehorning that headline in, singer-songwriter Garth Brooks has announced his plans to take his show on the road when he next returns to Ireland, which he hopes to do very soon. Now, joining us to talk through today's top stories, our own Tomás McDermott from the Communications Clinic and from the Irish Times, Jen Hogan. Thank you both very much joining us. Let's have a look at the... Before we get to Garth's threat to the nation, we'll have a look at another threat to the nation. I suppose it's worth noting on the blackout story, this is more preparation, Jen, for if the worst comes to the worst. This isn't the news that it's actually going to happen, that there will be blackouts, but should there be a certain fall in our energy availability or our capacity, then we'll have blackout, we'll be facing blackouts.
Yeah, like you said, this absolute worst case scenario. Right. Although we have been warned that it's more likely than it was 2 weeks ago and more likely than it was 2 weeks before that. But if we see a 20% reduction in gas supplies from the UK over a sustained period of time, that being days or perhaps a little bit longer, we're going to be, and we can't manage to get usage under control through data centres or huge consumers of energy. We are looking at rolling blackouts across the country, and it will affect households from periods of maybe half an hour up to 4 hours at a time, and very few people are going to escape. We will be warned in advance. People will be warned in advance, and obviously hospitals and emergency services will be protected.
Yeah, I was just about to ask that, Owen. Where exactly are we going to see places hit, because the last thing you want is for a hospital or for essential services to be struck down because of a blackout.
Precisely right. So ESB networks are going to be the people, along with AirGrid, who'll be doing an analysis if such a horrific scenario were to occur, where they'll do an analysis across the country. But there will be some places that are off limits, so to speak, that they wouldn't be affecting. Hospitals, for example, would be within that. Garda stations are also acknowledged that they that would be not ideal, that they would close. There will be other places like government departments, so that they have areas that they will say these won't be on the list. The term that they use is load shedding, so that they'll be looking for places that they can take off the grid to allow the electricity to maintain within that. But as Jen mentioned, they will be going to the high energy users, first of all. So data centres, for example, will be on that list. I think people have been criticising data centres. Certainly, they take 15%.
What do you mean they'll be going to them first?
Turning them off or asking them to manage it. So ultimately, the story that's being outlined in the Sunday Independent is the worst case scenario for the citizen. But before it ends up coming to our homes, for example, closing down, there are a number of measures or mitigations that they're going to try and include. And one of that will be working to the data centre, saying, lads, you need to cool the jets a little bit, because taking 15% of the country's electricity is quite substantial anyway.
Yeah, absolutely,
so they're looking at that, for example.
I also noticed one for the kids. Well, ATMs could be down. No, that's not for the kids. But the schools could be gone as well.
That sentence struck fear. Fear.
It's across the country, I imagine.
I haven't recovered from the school closures the last time, and the idea that the schools could lose power supply and what that might actually mean. Will they be able to continue? Will be able to stay open if that's the case?
It is worth noting, and like I said at the beginning, this is a contingency plan. This is not necessarily expected to happen. What would the timeline be? Like, could it happen next week? Could it happen? Where are we looking into the depths of winter?
No, they're looking at into the depths of winter. Right. Well, they are looking to say, well, if it does, is the reduction of the 20% from our supply from the UK. Like, it is worth noting as well that we do get 70% of our gas from the UK, and even geographically, without stating the obvious, we're on the west coast of Europe on an island, so we're literally at the end of the pipe. So we really are at risk, and this level of contingency planning, I think, is perhaps an indicator of some of the fears that government have. It makes total sense that government, the other stakeholders, like the energy suppliers, like the hospitals, for example, like AirGrid, are planning for the worst case scenario. Obviously, the hope is that it wouldn't occur. But in terms of the timeline, it would be moving into the higher dependency months of November, December and January. Yeah. But you'd have to say, if they're planning it, they must see it as a potential reality coming down the line. But obviously, and we would hope
plans to be prepared.
It.
Yeah, that's it, be prepared. Yeah. Probably worth prefacing the next story with exactly the same warning, which is like, it's not actually, and we don't want to be like, oh, Virgin Media or RNDM are saying that here comes COVID. But it is worth noting that this is a plan for, not just for COVID, but as they described, the twindemic, Jen.
The twindemic. They're looking to Australia, I suppose, and they're watching what's happening there. And the big fear is that this, we are going into a really seriously challenging time for the HSE again, as COVID cases increase, but this time flu as well, particularly because we had reduced numbers of flu due to restrictions and things in previous years. So the warning is that the health service is under huge pressure and they're worried how they'll cope. Already they're looking into renting private ambulances and sending recruiting the services of public hospitals in certain situations, looking at getting services to stay open longer, maybe have social workers and healthcare workers working over weekends so they can work through discharges more efficiently at weekends, having greater numbers of them, and looking at extending working hours. But they have huge problems with recruitment. They have huge problems with recruitment. We will have problems again with illness as we go into the winter too, with illness with staff. And it's all combining and all coming together to make for the potential perfect storm.
Yeah, I think that this twin demic perfect storm, Owen, I suppose the one element of it is the COVID that we're still keeping an eye on, but it's, you can nearly set your watch by the flu season.
Totally, and we followed the southern hemisphere. So Australia, for example, gets their flu season before we do. And so what the immunologists in the northern hemisphere do is look to see, well, what strain of flu is it? How significant an impact of it? And what was the damage done, for example, within it? And what they found is that the Australian flu season, which was much worse than they've had for the last 5 years, that it started earlier, which is significant, and also that the symptoms were more severe, and that we can expect a version of that happening over the winter months. So when you look, for example, flu season tends to begin perhaps around November, maybe into October, you're looking at that. So there is the risk around that, Ray, as well as then the expectation that we will have another wave of COVID. But on a very basic level, the health service is there to provide healthcare services, and that you'd look to say, well, they need people to do it. There is a risk around recruitment, but also that staff will get sick. There is a need for beds. There is an expectation, though, that over 75s are going to be staying in the beds for longer. There is then also trolley issues. We've waiting lists. So as Jen described it, the perfect storm. Like, winter has never been an easy time for the health service. Yeah. And that we look then, pre-COVID it was difficult, during COVID it was difficult, but now with the look at the twindemic, they're expecting another pretty severe.
Yeah, and they need to prepare for that, I suppose. The worst may not come to pass, but they need to be prepared for the worst, which is again worth noting. It's not all doom and gloom. It's more doom and gloom.
Jen,
you can take this one and break the terrible news of we're going to be spending more at the pumps.
Yes, the carbon tax is rising.
Finally coming in,
on October 12th, and it's going to cost us £1.28 at the pump to fill our tanks with petrol. And £1.48 for diesel. So no relief really for consumers. No relief in that respect. We will still have the reduced public transport costs. So we still have that at least, but it's going to be a more expensive time again for motorists as we continue to go into our cost of living crisis and we go into the winter where we have all these extra costs. So it is bad news again, probably not unexpected, but bad news again, even though members of the opposition and even politicians within the government parties have been concerned and have been asking for this to be parked.
Was it not the case that they were at loggerheads internally in the government themselves, and they were like, this is not the time to be bringing it in?
Yeah, but it's going ahead October 12th.
Right, okay. 12th of October, we'll be keeping an eye on that.
Yeah, well, when you look at the price, like AA had a research out this week where they were saying that we were spending €440 more per year than we were last year. So it's significant
and going up again now.
And it's going up again. And also the question is, well, if you could pause the excise duty on, for example, home heating oil until next May, why couldn't you pause the carbon tax, for example, on the fuel?
Yeah,
so it's
again.
Interesting. And again,
and the expression of perfect storm in terms of, like, with the fuel prices themselves going up and then adding this on top of it, but it's expected that they have to add it. Now we need to talk about himself. He made a threat to the...
A promise, a hope, an aspiration.
Do you know what? I love him. I love him. And I'm only sorry I couldn't be there last night because, like I said, I was there the week before, and he was fantastic. And to go on his last night, mm-hmm. where he's bringing out, apparently he did a Queen medley last night as well. Wow. He was absolutely phenomenal, and we saw him in the news. Garth Brooks coming back to Ireland. How do you feel, Jen?
Well, I haven't seen him this time, and I was never really inclined. But now you said the Queen melody, or medley.
No, it wasn't the Queen of England. It was Freddie Mercury.
That's the one I was hoping about. The Queen medley. No, absolutely. That might inspire me to next time. Plus, I have the real FOMO, because everybody has been to it. Everybody has been
literally
to
everybody,
it.
Literally
everybody. Yeah, everybody has been to it.
What, an eighth of the country. Yeah. Did you go on?
I was there last Saturday, and I loved every single moment of it. It was a wonderful experience. He was amazing, but it was brilliant, wasn't it, to be around 80,000 people just there to have a fantastic time, and I'll be in the queue for the ticket if he was to come back.
Well, he's
again.
Saying he's going to tour. He might see more of the country the next time, so we could be looking at Páirc Uí Chaoimh, we could be looking at Thomond Park. He might even do the local hall. You won't have to travel far. We look forward to welcoming him back whenever he does come. Thank you both for joining us, Jen and Owen. Much obliged. Right, there's lots of time for you to get in touch. Were you there? Did you see him last night for the How Was the Queen medley? Text or WhatsApp on the number. It's 0896 111 111. You can email irlandam@virginmedia.ie, and you can find us at IrelandAMVMTV on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. Up next, we get a lesson in pronouns and how to use them correctly. We'll see you after the break.
Welcome back. The correct and incorrect way to use other people's pronouns has been making headlines over the past fortnight.
Understandably, especially for certain generations, there might be confusion as to the correct way to refer to someone in the way that they would like to be referred.
Here to discuss is Laura Louise Condell, volunteer manager from Spun Out. Laura, good morning.
Good morning.
Firstly, what are your pronouns?
My pronouns are she, her. Thank you for asking.
And that is kind of the conversation, but for anyone at home who may not know, what are pronouns?
So pronouns are basically what you refer to someone as when you're talking about them and not using their name. So say, for example, after this, you'll be like, Laura Louise, she was so amazing. the pronoun there. Why are you laughing?
She was dead right in saying she was so amazing.
The pronoun there was she.
Yes.
So it's important to remember that then in discussion. When your interchange, your exchange there, just as you met.
Yes.
When Paul asked you, what are your pronouns?
Yes.
Is that expected to be the common way you would engage for the first time meeting someone in future? Hi, I'm Ray. Nice to meet you. Would you discuss the pronouns, or at what point does it come into the conversation?
Oh, that's a great question, because I think it depends on the situation and the circumstances. A way you could do it, though, would be to introduce yourself and give your pronouns automatically. So you could show to somebody that if they want to give theirs back, that they can. So I could go, hi, I'm Laura Louise. My pronouns are she, her.
Okay.
And then if the person isn't feeling comfortable to share theirs back, they're not necessarily put on the spot to do so.
Okay.
And then if it's appropriate, you could ask them in a private, maybe, or if it is just one-on-one, like, what are the pronouns you'd like me to use for you?
It's been integrated into our life more and more. We see TikTok do it, Instagram do it, you know, Twitter do it. They all now integrate you can use your pronouns.
Yes.
But that's only been, especially the social platforms, that's only been over the last year. It's safe to say that over the last 10 years, pronouns coming into conversation and having conversations like we have, that is now more prevalent.
Oh, absolutely. So, for example, the most commonly used pronouns in Ireland are she, her, he, him and they, them. Mm. And I only heard they, them for the first time in 2017. So I'd even say the last 5 years, then the last 2-3 years. And I actually think in a way, I don't want to say the pandemic kind of helped that, because everything was online. So it was kind of easier to bring pronouns in for a lot of people, just popping them up on Zoom rather than kind of saying it verbally. So I think it definitely helped to speed up introducing them.
And I think the pandemic was a soul-searching mission for a lot of people who then, you know, went down that route of kind of researching their pronouns and how they felt about themselves and how they identified. Mm-hmm. Am I right?
Oh, absolutely. People had a lot of time and less distractions to maybe distract yourself from thinking about those things that could be difficult. And a lot of people were trying to discover who they are and also try out things like putting their pronouns up. Or maybe they've been thinking, OK, I might identify as non-binary, or I don't think that she fits me anymore. So they might try out using a pronoun on Zoom or something, and the pandemic gave them the opportunity to do that.
Right. Yeah. So talk us through then they, them in particular, because you mentioned she, her.
Yes.
We mentioned older generation. It's not necessary. You don't even need to necessarily be that old to not want to get a grasp, but to make sure you get it right. She, her, he, him. We got. Talk us through they, them, and why would people be using the pronoun they, them?
So there's lots of different reasons that people would use they, them. For some people, it's simply because he or she doesn't fit and it's the only one that might do the job. Like in the absence of he and she definitely not working, it might be okay for them to use they, them. It might be because they feel they associate with that. A person might identify as non-binary. They might be transitioning their gender and they might feel comfortable with they, them for a short period of time and then change their pronoun again. So lots of different reasons why people use they, them. And I would also not assume someone's gender identity if they are using they, them.
And I suppose you say there, but if it might not fit, right? And that's to do with how you're feeling about yourself and how you identify in your own body. Because people at home might be watching going, what does she mean? What does she mean by the fit? But that's about how somebody might be assuming for themselves and in their gender.
Yes. And as well, I think, you know, we live in such a gendered world. We've been raised to gender everything. Like, I don't even mean just people. So, you know, we look at people, people automatically, I imagine, would think I'm she, a woman. People would perhaps look at the two of you and think he's a man. But also, you see a dog. Oh, he's such a cute little boy.
Yeah.
My sister's car, Duncan. You know, we even gender inanimate objects. So I think I know for a lot of people, the concept of, OK, what about taking out those gendered terms can be really difficult. But yeah, they, them could actually be a really way of just kind of freeing people from that expectation of the male or female if they don't feel like they fit into that.
And in terms then of offending someone or putting a foot wrong or saying the wrong thing or doing the wrong thing, how, I suppose, hurtful or how damaging can that be then to I suppose, intentionally misuse pronouns?
Yes, and I think the intention part is really important there, because mistakes are, by their nature, mistakes. They're accidents.
I've made them.
I still make them all the time, and I've been concentrating on pronouns and being aware of that for, like, the last 5 years. Mm. It still happens, of course it does, but the difference is the intention. And if you do intend to do it, it can be extremely harmful for people, actually. So I think a way to... I was trying to think about this in a way that, say, for example, I think when people get resistant to using they, them pronouns or asking people their pronouns or having this conversation, it's they're thinking about themselves and any inconvenience or discomfort that they might feel. But actually, respecting someone else's pronouns is about the other person. And to be honest, it is... honestly, a small ask that can have a massive impact on someone, positively or negatively. If you don't respect someone's pronouns, like, you can chip away at their self-esteem, because it's not just you. It could be a lot of people. And if someone is over and over mispronouncing you, it can really start to impact you. For example, if someone called me he over and over, I'd be like, why won't you call me she? What's wrong? Like, why won't you accept me? You know, so it can really hurt somebody.
I suppose, that is an interesting way of thinking of it, that the pronoun that you take for granted, or that
it is
who you are. It is a part of your identity.
Yes.
And by refusing it, you are actually,
that goes a lot towards your self-esteem and your self-worth.
You know, but that said, though, it is about the intent, and some of us are utterly ignorant and doing our best with the best will in the world.
Absolutely.
There was one night on the 6 o'clock show, we were having a similar discussion about someone who was in entertainment showbiz story, and I kept saying she instead of he or vice versa. And I kept having to be corrected. And like I say, it was not my intention to offend. And I think a lot of us feel that way, that it's like, with the best will in the world and with no intention of offending, we still manage to do it. What would your message be to those people?
Oh, that it's about building habit.
Yeah.
We've been in the habit for our whole lives of using he and she, and also of looking at someone and saying he or she as well. So sometimes if somebody has a name that we might associate with female, say, or a look we might associate with female, and then we find out their pronouns are they, them, or he, him, it can be hard for our brains to switch out of that. But the more you practice, it does become more natural. Mm. Like, honestly, it's pretty normal for me now to just refer to everyone I don't know as they.
Yeah. Okay.
It does with time. Now, sometimes I still struggle. Like, we had somebody come to cut the trees in our back garden, and I was back saying, "Oh, he did a great job. He was a great man to do the trees." And I was like, "No, the person who came to cut the trees did a great job.
So the great message is there that we're still learning and we're all still kind of finding our way around everything. So just be patient and make sure, as Ray said, the intent is there in the right manner.
Yeah, and you know, it is a little bit of effort in the beginning, and you might find yourself embarrassed or having to be corrected,
totally,
and no one likes being corrected. Mm-hmm. So you're kind of like, oh, sorry. And you might even find yourself getting defensive then.
Yeah.
But over time, it becomes easier once you practice.
We learned something, Louise. Laura, thanks a million.
Thank you so much.
And wasn't she brilliant?
Yes.
She really was brilliant.
She is amazing.
More information on what we spoke about today, you can check out spunout.ie, or you can use their free 24/7 text service for help and information by texting 50808.
Alternatively, you can contact Transgender Equality Network Ireland on teni.tenie.ie.
We'll take a quick break. We'll see you in a bit.
Oh, what a beautiful morning.
Beautiful.
You told me to sing it.
I did. I said to him before, I said, are you going to sing that?
I did what I could. I did what I could with limited talent. That's the story of my career. It's almost 10 o'clock on Sunday, the 18th of September. Lots more still to come between now and midday.
It can be one of the most nerve-wracking parts of any wedding, the best man speech. Well, we've got advice from a professional to make sure he stays in line and doesn't leave you red-faced on your big day.
Grab your Tamagotchi. We're travelling back to the 90s. From grunge to power suits, we're taking your autumn wardrobes back 30 years.
She starred in massive Irish productions like The Snapper, Ballykiss Angel, The Field, Moon Boy, and most famously, My Left Foot. Actor Ruth McCabe will be stopping by.
And Lizzy Lyons is on kitchen duties this morning. Great news for us, at least. Lizzy, what are we having?
We are making a really nice linguine this morning with some cream and white wine sauce, chicken, pancetta, and lovely fried mushrooms.
Oh, the studio smells gorgeous already.
Is it going to be as nice as your pasta last night?
It is, yeah, but not as nice as my singing, has to be said. Now, let's have a look at your Sunday newspapers as you're waking up, starting with the front page of the Sunday Independent. They lead with revealed HSE's twindemic winter warning. They report that the HSE is preparing itself for potentially one of the worst winters in years due to a predicted twindemic of coronavirus and flu outbreaks.
The Business Post opens with state aid scheme to provide new electricity grants of up to €500,000 for struggling firms. They write that the government is preparing a new scheme that will allow energy-intensive businesses to apply directly for grants to offset the soaring price of electricity.
The front page of the Sunday Times reads Northern traders torn over closing for royal funeral. The paper claims that businesses in Northern Ireland, and in particular in Derry, are divided over whether or not to shut their doors tomorrow for the Queen's funeral.
Onto the tabloids, the Irish Mail on Sunday leads with serving soldiers claim sex assaults. They write that more than 100 witnesses have given evidence suggesting a culture of harassment in the Defence Forces, with at least two serving members having given testimony stating that they were sexually assaulted on duty.
And the Irish Sunday Mirror opens with Gardaí face drug tests by Christmas. The paper reports that new Garda recruits are to face mandatory drug testing this year as part of a systemic crackdown on corruption.
Over to the Sunday World, which leads on Mulls Royce lifestyle. The paper describes the millionaire's lifestyle enjoyed by the Kinahan money launderer Johnny Morrissey and his wife prior to his recent arrest, with the pair having invited a lifestyle magazine into their home for an interview earlier this year.
And finally, with The Sun on Sunday, and it opens with Garth, I will be back. Singer-songwriter Garth Brooks has announced his plans to take his show on the road when he next returns to Ireland, which he says he hopes to do very soon.
Now let's get another check on the weather you're waking up to.
For car insurance, van insurance or home insurance, call the Quote Devil. Unless, of course, you've got money to burn.
This morning we can expect brief spells of mist with mostly dry conditions and a few isolated showers in northwest parts of the country. Temperatures will range between 9 and 13 degrees. The afternoon will then see mostly cloudy skies with more sunshine as we move through the day and temperatures ranging between 16 and 18 degrees. And tonight we'll see more cloudy conditions with some isolated showers and patches of fog across the country. Temperatures overnight will range between 7 and 12 degrees.
For first-time drivers, young drivers, returning drivers, if you've had an open claim or have had too many penalty points. The quote devil's always got one hell
of a quote. Have you been away much lately?
You can't keep me in the country. I'm away as much as I can.
Any problems with you know, flights and being stuck anywhere?
The only problems I have are that I've got two kids. Yeah, and they insist on them coming with us. Usually.
Okay.
Yeah, but besides that, we've been actually fine. And when you consider that all the delays and all the problems coming through the airports and stuff, we were actually grand. We were well prepared, and we knew where we were at. Why, Jazz?
So Ryanair passengers on board a Dublin to Portugal flight got quite the surprise last night when their flight, intended for Faro in Portugal, actually landed in Malaga, Spain, which is over 400 kilometres away.
Where were
from
they flying
city.
From?
Dublin.
Oh, right, OK.
They were supposed to go to Faro in Portugal, but they went to Malaga, you know, just because.
Just to mix it up a bit.
Yeah, just. Right. The flight landed, get this, in Malaga at about 2 a.m. and was explained by a Ryanair spokesperson as a disruption caused by the French air traffic control strikes.
Of course,
which
yeah.
caused the Ryanair plane to miss curfew for landing in Faro Airport. Of course, Ryanair didn't tell the passengers. Because why would we?
I
will fix it.
You're still going on your holiday, sure.
Yeah, everyone's going. But one passenger, a man named Barry Masterson, was good enough to live tweet the entire affair.
Right.
As seen in Barry's tweet, the 157 passengers were squeezed onto a five-hour shuttle bus at 2 a.m. from Malaga to Faro overnight. Barry writes, "We're on a five-hour bus to Portugal now and we've stopped for petrol and P stops within 5 minutes. I'm never getting out of here. One bus for 157 people.
Oh my
Good
God.
Luck to everyone we left behind."
It's not that airport standing up shuttle bus, is it? It was like a proper bus at least they gave them. Oh my God, could you imagine?
So many people were left behind, with one commenter replying that his girlfriend was on the flight and had to get a taxi to Faro as there was no room on the bus, so she had to get a five-hour taxi. The ordeal didn't end there. It gets worse, as the passengers were made to swap buses with nearly an hour delay at the border.
Because, of course, you're crossing over. You had to go over to Portugal. Well, hopefully you enjoyed your holidays, nonetheless.
Yeah,
we're not laughing, I can imagine. Well, I was saying, at least you're going on your holidays. Would you not just stay in Malaga? Like, Costa del Sol is lovely. At this time of year, you might as well just stay there, see if you can grab an Airbnb or something.
The best thing about it was, at the end of the night, once everything had kind of calmed down, Barry was able to confirm that Ryanair did not play the celebration music when the plane first landed.
I can imagine, after 5 hours on a bus, ta-da! you've made it.
You've landed somewhere else.
What have I got for you? This is the watch list. Did you ever, you know, on your streaming services,
yes.
you can watch the trailer and you go, "Jeez, I like the look of that. I'll click on it and to watch later."
Yeah.
How many episodes or programs do you have on your watch list?
Oh, there's probably I'd say a good 15 to 20, and like I've probably dipped in.
I've got years worth. Yeah. When is it Netflix that gives you the trailer? Like, as soon as you turn on Netflix, it starts showing a trailer. I hit add to watch list on everything.
Yeah.
And I've got years worth.
And will you watch it?
No, right. God, no. Okay. I'll watch the trailer. I'll watch the trailer for the next thing and then add that to the watch list. That's my Netflix viewing experience. This is a new survey. According to a new study, the average person has 13 TV shows and 16 movies on their must-see list, averaging a total of 104 hours. You've got 104 hours of stuff to watch there. On average, of the people polled, 42% were brave enough to admit they'd probably never get through their watch list. Check, how you doing? The most popular shows on the watch list. You ready?
Mm.
Well-known shows at the top include Stranger Things at 24%.
Yeah.
Game of Thrones. I'm watching The Dragons actually at the moment.
House Dragon. Very good.
The Walking Dead, Breaking Bad, Squid Games at 19%, and Living with Lucy at 7%. I'm joking.
I was looking at the graphic going, what's it?
It should be. We can't get enough of her.
What's on your watch list? We want to know. There's still plenty of time to get in touch. You can text us for free on WhatsApp. The number is 089-611-111.
You can email irlandam@virginmedia.ie.
And, of course, you can find us at IrelandAM VMTV on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram.
After the break, a blasta pasta. I like the sound of that. I'll have a blast of that pasta in the kitchen. We're dining Italian style in just a minute.
Welcome back. As we're sure you're all aware, last Thursday was a momentous day around the world. International Linguine Day.
Oh, of course.
A global holiday celebrating the best of all pastas. We missed you on the big day, but it's never too late for a bit of pasta.
Joining us now to celebrate this momentous occasion, it's Lizzy Lyons from Lizzy's Little Kitchen. Good morning,
Lizzy. Good morning. How are you?
Looking gorgeous and creating gorgeous.
Yes, it's all going on here. Look at all these pots and pans.
You are busy woman today.
Busy.
Busy Lizzy.
Busy Lizzy.
So, Linguine today then?
Linguine, yeah. So we are going to do a basic kind of roux and add in some cream into it. It's kind of, it's nice and light. It's not kind of, it's nice and light. It wouldn't be as heavy as a carbonara.
Okay.
It's a bit cheaper to make. And yeah, we'll get started anyways. So the first thing we are going to do is we have some onions here. So we're going to get some onions into the pan here and start frying them up.
Bit of heat on that.
And what we do with the onions is we just let them sweat off for maybe four minutes, and until they become translucent.
So you don't want to brown them up.
No, we're not browning them. We're just making them translucent. They're just getting a little. We're cooking them off without putting colour on them.
Okay.
And then we have some 3 cloves of garlic here, and we're adding the garlic then for about a minute. We're just doing a little bit of a fast forward.
Mm-hmm.
It's not real time.
Are you a person who wants fresh garlic, or are you okay with the stuff that comes in a pot?
No, I like fresh garlic.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a massive difference. Do you ever find that if you eat something really garlicky and you get heartburn from it, you can be guaranteed it's paste? Well, that's what happens.
Like the fresh stuff in the freezer, like the squeezy stuff, is it?
Yeah.
In the fridge?
Yeah.
Interesting.
I would always...
We use the frozen... You know, it comes in a bag frozen, and it's kind of in pellets or little, you know.
Yeah. It's been chopped and it's been blasted, frozen, and then into. No, they're grand.
Okay.
It's just the paste.
The paste is the bad.
Yeah, because they'd have like a preservative in it, and.
Oh, I gotcha.
Yeah.
We use the frozen one. That's like I say, and you just use a little bit then that you need. Because we never go through the whole clove of garlic.
Yeah.
You buy 4 cloves. You can left it stick like left it free.
Yeah. The bottom of the onion drawer.
So you've had a bit of a season there.
We added in a little bit of pepper.
Yeah.
And we're just going to let that brown off. And what we do then is we take it out and we leave it to the side. But just because we're short and a little bit of time, I'm going to hurry it up.
Uh-huh.
And I'm going to put it all into the pan. But you'd be taking these out and then putting the next one in. Do you understand?
You're kind of creating a gorgeous little juice in the pan.
Yeah, so what we're doing is, if I was doing this at home now, I'd have to remove the onions and the garlic, and then I'd start with the mushroom, and we'd brown the mushroom off.
The smell of the onion and the garlic is
good. Yeah, onion and garlic are lovely. So you get a really nice brown there on the onion.
Lovely.
And then we're adding in pancetta. We're moving this off the pan again, and then we're adding. So when you're not washing loads of pans and you're just holding on to the same pan, and we're browning the pancetta as well until we get a really good crisp, and you'll see what I mean afterwards. I'll have it.
And so nothing should be overly cooked, nothing should be kind of too brown. You know, I can see you've got them there, they're sitting there.
Yeah, well, the mushroom should have a good browning on it, the pancetta should have a good browning on it, and that's it. The onion is translucent then.
Okay.
So we're going to start now on our sauce, and we're going to add in some butter into the pan here. I've just heated.
Lizzy, tell us, it's a big weekend, by the way, actually. Why is it a big weekend this weekend?
Oh, I had a little celebration yesterday.
For
my 30th.
Congratulations.
I don't know why you're
happy
laughing.
Birthday.
I'm not laughing,
Lizzy. Well, I know you didn't get to do exactly what you wanted.
No, I was supposed to go to Garth and I missed out.
Ah, listen.
Yeah, work calls. So...
Between me and you, Lizzy, I heard it wasn't good. It's
no,
grand. Don't worry.
I heard that too. Yeah, I heard that too.
You wouldn't have liked it. It was all country music.
I know. So what happens? There was some two lucky devils in Dublin yesterday, because I sent the tickets up to Dublin because I wanted somebody to enjoy them, and I gave them to a friend and she didn't use them, and somebody had the good fortune of meeting her. I don't know who it is, in a pub yesterday, and got 2 tickets to go to Garth Brooks.
That's lovely. At least what you use, yeah.
I wanted somebody.
If you were that person, drop us a text. So at 96111. Imagine we found them.
Yeah. So yeah, but look, these things happen. The next time he comes, or where's camera, Garth? If you're in Kerry, call into Lizzy's Little Kitchen, and I'll make you a really good breakfast.
I wonder if he's still around. He was in Kerry for a bit.
Yeah, he was. Yeah. So we have we've made a little roux here. I put in some butter and I've added some flour into it, and I have some chicken stock now.
and we're just bringing it together. It'll start thickening. You can see it thickening here.
Gorgeous.
Yeah.
And then over on your left should be the end result then of what,
exactly,
what it will look like at the
yeah.
end.
So we're going to let that thicken up.
Bit by bit. Yeah,
bit by bit, and it'll start thickening. And then once it's thickened, just imagine it has, we're adding in the cream into it, okay?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And now this is one that I prepared earlier, and I will show you. So these are the lovely mushrooms. Yeah. They got a really good brown on them.
Oh, so you've got them in their constituent parts.
Yes, these are ones that I cooked.
Right, okay, gotcha. From the
so you see
fries.
Now, this is the pancetta that was cooked really well. It got a lovely good brown
on
it.
And even all the flavours that are going to come through
exactly.
from the mushrooms.
So you have the wine, the onion and the garlic in here, the smokiness from the pancetta. Yeah. And then this is some chicken that I cooked off earlier.
Any and seasoning on that chicken?
No, I haven't, because there's a smokiness from the pancetta. You've got lots of flavours, the heaviness from the cream. Okay. I'm just going to put in a little bit of black pepper.
Just a minute and a half, Liz.
Yeah, and we're going to bring it all together.
It's gorgeous.
So it's a lovely, lovely dish, really easy to make. And I would tell anybody, like, if you're really busy and you're coming in late from work, having cooked chicken at the start of the week and putting them into the fridge is going to make your life so
but
easy.
Even this is a stock dish, do you know what I mean? Just to kind of keep in the fridge. I love that. As the days go by, you can just kind of pick away.
Yeah, and it stops you from eating bad as well, you know. It stops you from getting the pizza. And so this is some pasta that I've already cooked through.
Oh, so you're all mixing it in together.
And we're mixing it all through.
Oh, wow.
Getting it together. So yeah, we are very busy this week. We have the Listowel races.
Oh, of course. Yeah.
We are on the ball. It's starting today, so I'm going down home and taking the kids to it.
This is exactly what you need on your birthday weekend then.
Yes,
Calling in to do this.
Yes.
Miss and Garth and the races on.
But I am quite sure, because I was so kind to give away my tickets, that if Garth...
Karma, Gareth
is coming to the Listowel races and he's calling in to me.
He's gonna go.
Apparently he loves horse racing and he's going to come in to me and I am going to sing lovely Listowel with him. It's my party piece.
I'm going to edge over and get a bit of a taste off this because I'm like literally salivating at the mouth.
Yeah,
absolutely. Perfect.
A little bit of seasoning on top. Spoon and fork necessity.
I'm going to go on this. Are you okay with that?
There you go.
I'm closest. Oh,
shall
to
wait.
I have to wait
till the outbreak, I suppose.
Oh. I'm going to get this now for you.
And of course, full recipe details are up on our website. Or as ever, if you call into Lizzie's Little Kitchen in Listowel, the woman herself will sort you out. Just maybe give it a couple of hours so she can get back down to Kerry.
Absolutely. She'll be your friends in low places. Gareth, call in. Call in and tell her we said, sing her happy birthday. Bring the guitar with you and the spur and the big hat. Lizzie, thanks as always.
Up next, advice
on how to write a wedding speech. Lads, get your pen and paper out for the best men in your life. You're going to want to take notes after this.
Welcome back. A speech at a wedding can be the most nerve-wracking part of the day. What are they going to say? Are they going to tell that story about that time we went travelling? Are they going to bring up my exes?
Here to offer some... Sorry, I was wiping cream off myself. I managed to get covered in linguine cream during the advert. Here to offer some sage advice to make sure that everyone stays in line and doesn't let family secrets slip is professional wedding speech writer Cormac Laddy. Cormac, thank you so much for joining us.
No worries, then.
I've got two next year. Two
no
best man's speeches.
Oh, dear God.
I suppose you need to be mindful as the best man and as opposed to, like, the bride or groom, because or maybe even the father of the bride, because everyone needs to make a speech at the wedding. And you do need to put in the preparation, don't you?
Preparation is the number one thing.
Uh-huh.
Weddings, they don't fall out of the sky. They don't just happen at the end of a shotgun like they used to years ago. Uh-huh. They're planned
this
out
is
in
expected,
advance.
Yeah.
There's 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, you know. So if you're, like, writing your speech on your arm the day before, like, around the morning of the wedding, it's, you know, you're setting yourself up for
a
fall.
That don't bother doing any work. It's like, I should be grand. I'll have a couple of drinks.
Yes.
Or I'll have a pint.
Oh, man. Oh,
I'll put a mic in hand and away I go. How did you get into speech writing?
My baby brother got married in 2012. I was getting married in 2012. My middle brother was the best man. And he arrived out to my house with a box of my favourite beer. And he said, listen, you're the writer in the family. I really need some help with this, you know. And so we sat down, had a few beers, and we'd gotten a few stories from his friends.
Uh-huh.
And after a few beers, I suppose, I was feeling a bit more poetic than usual, and I just said, geez, man, there might be a poem in this, you know? I said, would you do a poem? And he's, I would just do anything now at this stage to just to have it out of the way.
Yeah.
And so I wrote it out as a poem from then. I just coached him on the delivery of it, on just like how to learn it, how to engage with people. And my mother was terrified because, she just didn't, you know, I suppose she'd been longer in the tooth, has been to all the weddings where the speeches go really badly. And my brother just got up on the day, and I just, knocked it out of the park and standing ovation. And a guy came up to me and just booked me at the bar about an hour after that.
And was that how it all kicked off? And that was kind of the start of it? Was that the first speech you'd helped
write?
That
was the very first speech I ever helped write. And then I just got a phone call then not long after that. And I got a phone call then not long after that from someone who had just heard about the speeches. And I kind of had a lot going on in around then. And my daughter actually was in hospital. She was Newmar, but, you know, I remember being in Crumlin Children's Hospital and, you know, coaching guys on the the phone, going down to meet them in the Red Cow. And, you know, and that was actually, I had done the speeches for the best man, two groomsmen, and the head bridesmaid. All we had mics hidden underneath the tables, and the guys were passing the mics. It was a total surprise for the couple, and
to be used.
You get away with murder,
the work in. Talk me through the process of actually putting the speech together. I mean, should there be a focus on comedy? Should there be a lot of laughs in it? Should it be more heartfelt? Where do you begin? Where do you start?
I tell guys to start at the beginning. So if you're a best man or a dad or whoever you are writing a speech, you know. People are there to, they're there to get a little bit of an inside scoop on the couple, you know. Uh-huh. You don't have to be hilarious, but I think you really do have to be honest, you know. Now, that's not to say you have to put everything in, but if you are come across as genuine, that will really, really resonate with people instead of trying to be funny. Because if you're trying to be funny and you're not funny, it's just awful cringy. It's very, very cringy.
Yeah.
And if you start at the, you know, for dads, I say, listen, go back to the day your daughter was born, you know, what happened that morning? And they'd be like, oh, sure, we got the call. I was in work, we had to go, and sure, my car was broken down. I had to borrow her father's van, and we arrived into the coombe. Tell the story, you know, tell the story of their lives, you know, and same for best men. Start from there, you know. When was the first time your brother punched you? You know, can you pop, you know, when was the first time, what did you do? Did you wrestle? Did you, you know, what were the things you did
You're
together
going through
growing
all
up?
The different ways in life. Can we go through the do's and don'ts of,
sure, yeah.
of speech writing?
Yes.
So what would be the do's, say?
Start, if you're really worried, reach out to somebody for help. Mm-hmm. Plan it in advance. Do, you know, just start.
Start early.
Get in touch with, if you're a best man, sit down with the lads. If you're organising a stag and stuff for the groom, you know, you're going to have a WhatsApp group there for the lads, you know. And if maybe, you know, if you're an older brother or that, and maybe your brother's younger than you, you might not be kind of privy to all of his, you know, his college years
totally,
or growing
yeah,
up.
Yeah, there's a whole other life that they
reach out. Reach out to the lads, you know. Reach
get
out
the
to
insight
the lads
on all his friends
and get the insights, you know. And don't let it all be just about kind of kicking him to death in front of everyone, you know. Talk about his accolades. Do, you know, talk about things that he has done.
So get a bit of the good and a bit of the bad.
Two copies are important
to the speech.
Absolutely. And just be honest. The don'ts, don't do it on the morning of the wedding, you know.
Yeah, don't write it then.
Don't go onto the internet for, kind of the recycled jokes, the, you know, the really lame stuff. Nobody wants to hear it
bestmangroomspeech.com.
Best man jokes. Just don't, don't go
That's
there.
It's interesting that you've got don't go over 10 minutes. I've been to some weddings when I've been there for half an hour.
Oh,
man. We're all looking at our watches.
And I think one of the ways that the venues are getting away or getting around this now is they're making people do them at the drinks receptions, and they'll tell them, if your speeches go over X amount of time, we're going to charge you for 1 hour for every single person
of staff. God, it's almost like the Oscars. They're going to play the music and roll you there.
So if your speeches go over a certain amount of time, you know, you could be another two or three grand in the hole for, you know, for some fella who doesn't know how to shut up.
Time wasted.
And vulgarity is important not to kind of let that kind of ease.
There's no place for it, man. Yeah. Swearing, you know.
Moms and dads are there, as well.
Nobody wants to hear it. Yeah, really not. Leave it out and be yourself, you know, and just be honest.
Tell me, this is a delicate one now, that, like, if maybe a parent has passed away or there's been a tragedy in the family, is there an appropriate way of addressing it in a speech like that, or is it best to just avoid?
No, I would say honour that person.
Yeah.
You know, honour their name, honour their legacy, honour what they mean to the family. I think it's so important because weddings are a coming together of family, of friends, and, like, nobody gets out of this alive, you know, and people who pass away are just some of the, like, the most influential, you know, the people who brought you into the world. They put food on your plate, they put clothes on your back. And I think a wedding is the perfect place
to honour them.
And that's why I say to my best men as well, you know, stay in honour.
Yeah,
you know.
And in a joyful way, right?
And in a joyful way, you know, and bring it in, speak about them, but, you know, don't dwell on it. But honour their memory because it has a place in the wedding, you know.
Absolutely.
And that's where your
start
preparation
early.
Comes
right,
in.
I'm yeah. starting today then.
Yeah.
Cormac,
right,
thank I'm writing you them all so down. Much for chatting to us.
Don't get too drunk. I like the emphasis on two. Cormac, thank you very much. For more advice from Cormac, check out his website, bespokeweddingspeeches.com.
If you bought smash hits and couldn't figure out if you'd rather snog Luke Perry or Jason Priestley, then we've the perfect fashion retro rewind for you on the catwalk. See you soon.
Luke, definitely. Luke.
Welcome back. Are you set to spice up your life? Well, this autumn fashion trends are taking us back to the 90s. Stylist Roz Lipsett has a handle on the craze and joins us now. Roz, good morning.
I'm so happy. The 90s are back.
Now, yes. We're starting with a very Sarah Jessica Parker stylist look. We're going to have a check out now at the actual the style itself here. First.
So Sex and the City is so iconic. It came on our screens in the late 90s and it was anything goes. It literally, they had fun with fashion and people were recreating their looks worldwide and things were so accessible because there was the rise in high street.
And this is your version today. It's beautiful.
We decked Yumiko out and she's wearing a full look from Fee & Co Boutique in Port Marnock and in the Swords Pavilion and online at feecoboutique.com. And we went for that very Carrie Bradshaw. She's so Vogue obsessed. So we went for a Vogue t-shirt, really fun. We glammed it up here with the tutu, which was really well known for, the tall skirt that we're seeing all over the runways. Yeah. The 90s are back with this beautiful cream kind of oversized coat.
Staple piece.
Oh, such a staple piece. And it just makes the whole look so luxurious. Again, monochrome is just so rich, so beautiful, and very 90s.
The knit elastic sleeves, I like those too. That's a different take.
It's comfy, yeah. And then you can also pull up your sleeves to make it like more of a slouchy style. And then can we talk about these gloves? Gloves are back, baby, and I am loving it. Well, Paula Rowan, as we saw, created gloves for Lady Gaga.
The Queen.
And everyone in the 90s and the 80s loved gloves. And these are just so pretty, they're so dainty, and they'll be beautiful to keep your hands warm when you're going out for that Christmas stroll. Again, the bag and the accessories are all kind of jazzed up, like the belt, it's very Chanel inspired, just to really nod to the 90s when Versace and Chanel blasted on the runways with all the 90s supermodels. We've layered the jewellery up because bling was in, anything went, and all the jewellery today is from bettyandbiddy.com.
Brilliant.
The now, chunky hoops as well, so classic, hoops. Such a 90s staple, even Princess Diana was a big fan.
Our next look was very supermodel based, wasn't it?
Oh, well, the big six, you know, we had Kate Moss, Cindy Crawford,
Linda,
obviously can't forget Linda, and we had Naomi, and this is the pantsuit that Gianni Versace first created in the 90s that drove drove people wild. It really started that glamazon period where anything goes, bright colours were so in, and now this is a more modern day take, and this pantsuit is from Pamela Scott, in stores nationwide and online at pamelascott.com. It's really fun, it's really bright, it also comes in a really poppy orange and a gorgeous electric blue. It's kind of got that relaxed feel, so we've popped a t-shirt under it just for that more kind of, you can wear it during the day or you can wear it to an event, or you can make it more, you know, dressy with.
And you can do it as two pieces, you could throw the jacket with jeans, you could throw the, you know what I mean?
It is so much separately. You can kind of totally, yeah.
Play
and,
with.
And then we've added just a nice little simple pair of white, or sorry, gold heels, just to really kind of complement the look, and a sparkly gold bag. Again, this is just so 90s inspired, when the pantsuit became such a key piece. Yeah. Women started power dressing and wearing what the hell they wanted. And that's why we're seeing that again. We're seeing that kind of anything goes style of fashion. And we're also shopping our own closets. So there's a lot of things that you could actually recreate, maybe that you have kept from the 90s yeah. that are coming back as well, such as blazers teamed with, you know, maybe a white top and things like that. Again, the jewellery is from Betty and Biddy and really layered it up, as layering was big. You could never have enough in the 90s, which was always so fun to style. And now our next
look.
We're
moving to All Saints now.
This, yes.
This, like, you know, All Saints Spice Girls, this was the look, you know, between the colour palette.
This was
between
me.
The slouch style, like this was, it. You're seeing it on screen there, the original, the OG All Saints.
Totally.
Would have had this look, and this is the take that we're going with now for 2022.
Well, we were just talking about it. This was us in our teens, Paul,
yes,
wasn't it?
Absolutely.
I was All Saints, the Spice Girls. They were my absolute idols growing up, and what great idols. They're absolute icons. They were strong women, and they wore what the hell they wanted. Yeah. This look is from F&F at Tesco, so you can pop in, and while you're doing your shopping, you can get this outfit. Also, you know, we're seeing a really big trend of sustainability now,
yes.
you know, which is so fantastic, because 50 to 70% of their collection is made with recycled materials. It's such a cool, fun look to recreate, from the bag, which is so quilted, 80s inspired with the chain, to this gorgeous little white vest, and then the flannel kind of oversized jacket with the combats, all the beiges, really, really gorgeous. And again, the sunglasses are also available there, and the jewellery is from Betty and Biddy. I loved that round sunglass look.
Yeah,
it was,
and it
very
really
90s.
A great thing for the shape of the face.
Yeah, it really does. Yeah. And it does give everything such a retro retro feel. Then we have the big chunky chains that we saw in the 90s. And I just love the way all of this is coming back. It's so fun. Looks absolutely gorgeous there.
The high-waisted trousers is a lovely yeah. little take on it as well, because the comfort and just to feel that kind of cover
totally.
In the midriff,
you know,
is
yeah.
always important.
They are actually combat joggers, so they're so, so comfortable. You know, I think back in the day it might have been that low waist, which I'm kind of happy I'm not seeing too much of that
yeah.
at the moment, to be honest. But yeah, now it is a bit more of a higher waist. It's a more commercial way to wear it too.
I love that we're now celebrating being comfortable.
Yes.
Love that.
100%.
Roz, they're gorgeous. We'll have three more a little bit later on.
Brilliant.
Brilliant. Still to come, legendary actor Ruth McCabe joins us. Plus, Shake Your Glitter Ball Strictly is back. We'll gab about all this week's top telly. We'll see you in a bit.
Gonna start the war.
Cabra.
Posa, mama, my dad, door be your birthday. You need to say, it's getting a black and a school shame.
Then rod jernach a dour tairshilam.
Mam.
Níl jere le an orscéal go fóla chrí. Os é tiam te gálan, é tach a rás.
Hadda bá mál éim ás a miáir.
Os é cap gónta?
Nís fín cairt ar andi a sin agus ní chóa meach an madras a siach an tosa.
Frank. Frank is anam dom.
Hey, Moiki. Om la madras sin ag múna am hóa níag da dit.
Spirit am a mani is mó hi rífig an bróst a sin.
Sio chwynge, ond tren Ali ymwane ys fiar sy tia.
Eist, ta tu clyste, ach ta nehe arehe sy seil sy na chdigyn tu.
Nid ys agat cada harlein dwi'n treis ar maa sialan. Nid ys agaynio.
Welcome back to the last hour of Ireland AM. It's Sunday, the 18th of September. Still, lots more to come in this hour.
Yes, she's considered one of the greatest names in Irish cinema and theatre. And with a CV that includes The Field, Philomena, The Snapper, My Left Foot and loads more, it's not difficult to see why Ruth McCabe joins us very soon.
Plus, fashion this season is giving us a cross between Cher at a Clueless and Rachel at a Friends. We're returning to the 90s over at the Catwalk.
And hopefully you've packed your lightsaber, because we'll be heading to a galaxy far, far away. Better pack a toilet bag as well, a toothbrush, because it's a galaxy far, far away.
I hope it's not a Ryanair flight.
We're reviewing the best on telly this week.
For car insurance, van insurance or home insurance, call the Quote Devil. Unless, of course, you've got money to burn.
This morning, we can expect brief spells of mist with mostly dry conditions and a few isolated showers in northwest parts of the country. Temperatures will range between 9 and 13 degrees. The afternoon will then see mostly cloudy skies with more sunshine as we move through the day and temperatures ranging between 16 and 18 degrees. And tonight we'll see more cloudy conditions with some isolated showers and patches of fog across the country. Temperatures overnight will range between 7 and 12 degrees.
For first-time drivers, young drivers, returning drivers, if you've had an open claim or have had too many penalty points. The Quote Devil's always got one hell
of a quote. Oh, you're very welcome back. I'm sleepy after that big bowl of pasta. Yeah? I could have a little nap. We had Linguine earlier on for breakfast. Come on. Let's have a look at your Sunday newspaper, starting with the front page of the Sunday Independent. And they lead with revealed HSE's twindemic winter warning. They report that the HSE is bracing itself for one of the worst winters in years due to a predicted twindemic of coronavirus and flu outbreaks. That's their preparations are underway for anyway, yeah.
The Business Post opens with state aid scheme to provide new electricity grants of up to €500,000 for struggling firms. They write that the government is preparing a new scheme that will allow energy-intensive businesses to apply directly for grants to offset the soaring price of electricity.
The front of the Sunday Times reads Northern traders torn over closing for royal funeral. The paper claims that businesses in Northern Ireland, and Derry in particular, are divided over whether or not to shut their doors tomorrow for the Queen Elizabeth's funeral.
On to the tabloids, and the Irish Mail on Sunday leads with servicing soldiers claim sex assaults. They write that more than 100 witnesses have given evidence suggesting a culture of harassment in the Defence Forces, with at least two serving members having given testimony stating that they were sexually assaulted on duty.
The Irish Sunday Mirror opens with Gardaí face drug tests by Christmas. The paper reports that new Garda recruits are to face mandatory drug testing this year as part of a systemic crackdown on corruption.
Over to the Sunday World, which leads on the Rolls-Royce lifestyle. The paper describes the millionaire lifestyles enjoyed by Kinahan money launderer Johnny Morrissey and his wife prior to his recent arrest, with the pair having invited a lifestyle magazine into their home for an interview earlier this year.
And finally, The Sun on Sunday with Garth, I Will Be Back. Singer-songwriter Garth Brooks has announced his plans to take his show on the road when he next returns to Ireland, which he says he hopes to do very soon. We saw in the news there, actually. What was the line? He said, once you've been, you can't come back fast enough.
It was almost a very Liam Neeson-esque style taken phone call.
I have a very particular set of skills.
and it's country and western.
It's country music and honky-tonk and covers. Apparently he did a Queen, a Freddie Mercury Queen medley.
This was the big encore that he always does kind of at the end. Now, Maeve texted us in on 0896111111. She said, I was at Garrett's concert last night and was a little bit disappointed. He took up enough time doing the Queen tribute and ended the concert with songs from Ed Sheeran and Don McLean. Yeah. He has so much material that fans wanted to hear. Wish live artists wouldn't do that. Now, I kind of like a bit of a spicy up when
one
does another.
In fairness, I don't want the album tracks. He said it from the outset as well, at least on the night I was there. He said, we're doing all the old stuff and we're going to do all the big hits. Mm. And in fairness, even the slow, I'm not even there for the slow songs. Like The River and The Dance, I could take or leave. I know that's blasphemous at this stage, but I'm not into it. I'm there to have a good time and to have a laugh. And then when the covers that he did are ones that you'd know anyway and done in a Garth style. That was brilliant. It really was very good. Nuala says, I wasn't sure about Garth Brooks, but everyone I know who saw him said he puts on a great show. He does. It's fantastic. And the other thing is, no more than the press conference that we watched in the news there, they're like, he's even on show. Do you know, like, it's all a shtick. But I love it. It's good fun. And the way he's like, I'll be coming back. Or,
Once you come back, you can't come back fast.
He's great.
Moving on to pronouns, which is a really interesting topic earlier on. Caroline says, my 16-year-old has arrived home from school just last week saying there was a massive debate and issues pertaining to pronouns. I can't believe it's causing this much of an issue. As a parent, you keep hearing the question, does it matter? And of course, the answer still is yes, it seriously does matter.
Yeah. Well, it matters to the individual.
Yes.
To the rest of us. It's no skin off our nose to do it. And do you know what? It won't matter once we all catch on and just do the appropriate thing. Once it becomes the norm, it's going to just be like, it's not going to matter.
And I think once they're having conversations in schools, I think that's a great idea about, like you said, it's no skin off my nose, but it might be off somebody else's nose. And just to kind of really open the spectrum of conversation, I suppose.
Megan says, it's people's lives and how they want to live. It's not harming you in any way, so why be mean about it? Just let them get on with their lives if they're happy. Just let them be happy with whatever way they want to identify. It's just common courtesy, and hopefully with discussions like this, more people will open up. And again, the interesting thing that we noted in the conversation earlier on, and you can get it on the watch back on the player, is that, like, with the best will in the world, you can still make mistakes. And there is an understanding that mistakes are grand, but going out of your way to intentionally make mistakes is the other matter.
Myself, I've been in the community for 35 years and I'm still learning. I'm still making mistakes. I made a mistake in Galway last week. I misgendered somebody and they called me up on it. And I just said, God, my apologies. I'm so, so sorry. I now know how to gender you correctly. And that's okay. We moved on from it. It's just a conversation of finding your way around it.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying?
I know. It's not an opportunity to have a row.
No.
Or to have a fight or to correct someone or pull someone up on it. Right.
In a bit of a better news, Ukrainian refugee becomes Irish Rover. The Shamrock Rovers are in the Daily Mail today with the story of how they took on a Ukrainian refugee as a midfielder on their football team. 7 months ago, Victor and his family lived a peaceful life in Odessa. He was a footballer. His wife, Natalia, was a model. They were proud parents to baby Alex. He'd been playing for a third-tier Ukrainian team. And, of course, their journey out of Ukraine had been terrifying. Mm. They spent the summer working in a fish factory in Cork. But his wife, Natalia, the model, she had got in touch with a London-based football agent whom she'd met kind of 6 years previously, who connected her to the former Celtic player Paul Byrne. And Byrne got Victor a trial with Shamrock Rovers, and he even put him up for 2 weeks while the team assessed his performance. And now they've taken him on.
Is he any good?
Listen, you're talking to the wrong person there. But if Shamrock Rovers want to give me some tickets, I'll go and see.
Yeah,
I'll see Victor.
The importing of talent, I suppose, is a good thing. It's fantastic.
But great. Like, you know, I was about to say Shamrock Rovers are a great team. I'm sure they are, but I would be lying if I felt like I knew.
What's his name again? What's your man's name?
Victor Serdenyuk.
Oh, right. Okay, Victor. Okay.
Are you going to Google him and see if he's good?
I'll give it a Google and see if he's any good. Yeah, worth keeping an eye on this season at least, as I'm getting stuck into the sport. More to come. A busy hour ahead for one more hour of the show.
Yeah, don't go anywhere. One of Ireland's most acclaimed actors joins us next.
Yeah, Ruth McCabe. She's in the building. We'll see you soon.
Welcome back. Our next guest to star alongside Hollywood royalty, won numerous awards and is one of Ireland's most beloved actors.
She hates us for saying it all now already.
She's giving us a look.
And now she is leading an all-star cast in the Blackwater Lightship, which premieres at the Dublin Theatre Festival later this month. It is, of course, the fabulous Ruth McCabe.
Oh, Ruth.
Madam, thank you so much for joining us.
Why did you say theatre?
Theatre. You are theatre royalty.
I know.
It's the Dublin Theatre Festival that the play is a part of. Give us a taste of the plot without giving too much away.
Well, we can give a lot away because in the first 8 sentences, you hear that a grandson is coming to his grandmother's house and he has AIDS. He's just been diagnosed with AIDS when it was a killer illness. Uh-huh. So that's where the play starts. It's and on it goes. I thought it was fantastic. It just jumped up off the page, and I mean, I remember that time. It was like beyond the COVID of its days. It's like the plague.
This is it. Particularly with COVID, has refreshed an awful lot of people's memories.
Yeah.
And what was that BBC drama? About the AIDS crisis.
It's a sin.
It's a sin.
Channel 4.
And it has certainly brought up a lot of memories for people of that time in particular.
Yeah.
What were your own memories of it at the time?
Well, just the fear.
Yeah.
Again, it was like contagion. It was the thing that it was a plague. The unknown quantity of it. I mean, people were dying.
Yeah.
Young people were dying. It was as if it was a gay plague. I mean, it wasn't. I mean, obviously, well, it was going into the whole.
That was what it was called. It was called the gay plague.
Yes, right.
You know what I mean? And
that's right.
You were distancing yourself, and like you say, there was the COVID barriers of get away, keep away, and
that's
stuff
right.
like that,
yeah.
and the stigma
homophobia.
As well that went with it.
Homophobia was quite normal.
And yeah, and the play deals with a lot of that content, I suppose.
Well, absolutely. It's the unspeakable.
Yeah.
It's what cannot be spoken about, and it has to be spoken about.
Yeah.
So you have the family, and then you have he arrives down with two of his pals. So you have like the gay community and the straight community meeting each other for the first time in a situation where they have almost no language.
And, even,
and like, it's funny.
I was going to say, yeah, heavy material.
Well,
like, yeah.
yes.
But there's moments of levity.
Yes, in one way. Yeah, well, I mean, of course it's heavy material.
Yeah.
But I mean, what makes it work is the fact that it's real and human and funny.
Yeah.
I mean, not all the time, but it is funny.
Yeah, there's funny bits as well. Worth
noting. Of course
noting.
There are.
Worth
of course there are.
I'm so delighted they landed you, Ruth. Theatre royalty herself.
Stop.
Yeah. Tell us about gigging. Tell us about, like, when you say it jumps off the page, when you get a script.
Well, it takes a long time, but I mean, if you're after, like, 20 pages, if you're saying to yourself, I'll just get a cup of tea and then I'll finish it, that's not a good sign.
Right, okay,
you want to be hooked in for the moment.
Of course, don't we all?
Yes.
I mean, think of when you're looking at something, you either believe it or you don't. Now, that's the mystery. Why sometimes do you believe it? And why other times do you just... not.
Yeah, it's just...
And with all business. The accolades as you move on through the career, does it jump out quicker now, or are you just sifting going, oh, God, or as a professional and a complete icon in your industry, does it you see it and kind of go, that's mine?
I suppose I trust my own instinct more
mm-hmm.
because there's times you can be sold something, you're being told that something is very good and it mightn't actually be good, and we all know it.
Mm.
There's something you think, oh, I'm not sure, but you do it because, and then you were wrong, and that's when you're kicking yourself. I think,
yeah.
I knew I shouldn't have done it.
We're looking forward
that's
to
the same for all of us.
Yeah, well, absolutely, yeah. That's absolutely true. You're doing a couple of, I'll actually give the dates in a couple of minutes because it looks fantastic. The Blackwater Lightship is part of the Dublin Theatre Festival. We mentioned the icons. Your man, was it Daniel Day-Lewis in My Left Foot?
My Left Foot.
And he's famous for the character or... Well,
staying in character.
The entire time.
Yeah.
Was that the case on My Left Foot?
Absolutely.
Right, what was that like? But, a method actor, sorry, yeah.
Well, I mean, it was so entirely respectful. I mean, can you imagine if he hadn't done that?
Yes.
To the respectful...
So think about that.
Yeah,
think
yeah.
about he strolls in the morning, he's perfectly able-bodied, and then he's pretending to have a cerebral palsy.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it would be appalling. It would
yeah.
be appalling. And myself and Brenda Fricker got a fit of laughter. It was just a wheelchair, it was rolling over. I mean, nonsense. We could not stop laughing. And then I remember thinking, as you always do, I better stop laughing now
oh.
and get it together. We were just giggling. You know, it's like laughing at the back of the class. And I remember seeing his hands, and they were so... wasted and thin because he hadn't been using them for a couple of months. He had actually been doing
that
everything
committed to it.
Yes. That it was profoundly moving, and I'll tell you, that straightened my back for me.
And refocused
smartly.
You to the,
yeah.
to the role, yeah.
So there's been Daniel Day-Lewis, there's been, you know, Colm Meaney, Brendan Gleeson, one of the leads in The Snapper.
Tina Kelleher.
Oh. Yeah.
Of
I mean,
course.
It again, it takes 25 years to realise not one taxi driver has ever asked me here, what's Tina Kelleher
what's her,
like?
What's herself like? Yeah. What is she like?
She's fabulous.
Awesome. Was it a fun experience?
It was great. It was great. I mean, that scene where she's breaking up to them about the pregnancy,
yeah.
that was 3 days.
3 days?
3 days, yeah. It's quite a long scene. It's longer than you'd think.
Did you go see the play adaptation?
No, I didn't. I couldn't at the time. I was really sorry. I wasn't around.
Yeah.
Did you see it?
I did. Yeah. Oh, my God. Epic. I actually saw it twice. Our own Simon Delaney had been in it as well.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Epic.
Yeah.
What like, going back to the Blackwater Lightship, I know you said it jumped out of the page. That's what drew you to it.
Yeah.
Is it a tough one to kind of... to do, like, do you feel drained? Do you get that draining feeling at the end of a
theater
of a rehearsal? Yeah, I
it's,
ask.
It's actually much tougher. It's very tough, yeah.
Because you're giving your all in that.
Yeah, and you're physically there, like you're on your feet all day, every day. Like we've been working very hard, but it's enormously satisfying too. Then I mean that rapport that you have. I mean, if the audience weren't there,
mm-hmm.
you would go home.
Yeah.
I mean, you wouldn't stay. So there's that feeling of. You're in the room at the same... We're all in the room at the same time. Like, for those couple of hours, our lives actually do depend on each other. And there's like, you hear the laughs and then you can feel the silence. And when the theatre is, when there aren't many in, it doubles your workload. When there's a full house, they carry you. I mean, I love being in the audience myself.
Yeah,
and seemingly what happens is our heartbeats are unified.
Really? Is that a thing? Is it synchronicity or synchronization?
Yeah, we become one. So I think that the communal experience must be very natural to us.
Yeah, well, it is. It's in our DNA.
It's on a
very primitive level. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's interesting that you say that about theatre. Would theatre then be your first love? Because, of course, you've won an IFTA. You're well, very experienced in, you know, on screen.
Yeah.
Would you always go for the theatre above it?
Well, it's absolutely thrilling.
Yeah.
I mean, somebody could drop dead in the audience on the stage. Like, anything could happen.
An air of tension. Yeah. Oh, I'm most likely going to, of any of us.
No.
I'm the one that's
no,
most likely.
No, I don't mean that. But it's like we are alive at the same time in the same moment. I mean, it's fantastic.
It is a different feeling. It's the same with live telly.
You're right.
Mentioned the IFTA, single-handed.
Yeah.
There was the cop drama back in 2012.
Yes.
What was that experience like?
It was great. I think I spent a lot of time looking out windows, didn't I?
Yeah.
I think I did.
Yeah. And the experience then of winning, when they call your name and say it's you, you're
that is, that is, that, that is quite a surprise. It's quite a thrill, yeah.
Yeah.
Were you prepared or not at all?
Not at all, right? Not at all. I didn't know.
But it's great to get that recognition.
It's lovely.
Talk to me about your favourites now, because you know we've talked about the Snapper, My Left Foot, Blackwater, Lightship. Now, is there a preference between the drama side of it and the comedic side of it? Because I know with Blackwater, Lightship, now you're going to be deep in the message, but you say there's also an element of comedy there.
Oh, indeed, there is.
Do you want the laugh sometimes and then the bit of drama, or have you got a preference for yourself?
Look, life is absurd. I mean, think of the amount of laughter there is at a funeral.
Yeah,
true.
Life is absurd.
That's it. There's been a lot of talk about that, particularly around the Queen's funeral and the queue and the mess around that. While at the same time being respectful, there's still a lot of laughing and joking.
But
I suppose.
Is hilarious, the hats.
Yeah,
have you seen the funny hats with the feathers?
Yeah.
And the black tights and the red and the gold. It's comedy gold.
Yeah.
And those little hairy boots.
Yeah, you find the funny in the series.
You find the funny bits in everything.
Yeah. Oh, will you do one thing for us before you go? Will you do Sulella? Do Virgin Media Television, Sulella. Because every time I hear your voice, I go, Sulella.
It's really?
Go on, give us a Sulella. No, you don't need to say Virgin Media, just say Sulella.
Sulella.
There it is. What a legend. The Blackwater Lightship runs between the 27th of September and the 2nd of October. It's at the Gaiety Theatre.
You're going to be in Blanchardstown
right?
On the 23rd and the 24th. Because there are some people who don't want to cross the Liffey. And that's their business.
That's absolutely fine.
Yeah.
And if that's your choice, that's totally fine. And understandable enough at times as well, has to be said. Friday and Saturday in Blanchardstown as well. You can see Ruth in action. Head over to the Dublin Theatre Festival.ie to book your tickets. Ruth, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Ruth. Right, after the break, we're returning to the 90s. Stay with us for more fashion next.
Sulella.
Welcome back. It was a simpler time before posh met Bex, and when you couldn't decide if you'd rather be Buffy Summers or Cher Horowitz. Yes, the 90s are having a revival, and stylist Roz Lipsett has stayed with us to guide us through the trend. Roz, the other three were great. Where are we going to now?
So there is just so many looks of the 90s that it was really hard to pick a few. But the next look we have here is... We're going to see on the screen now. This is the minimalism and the cast of Friends made such a big role in wearing things that we could all recreate at home. With the rise of the high street, we see our favourite character and Friends, like Rachel or Monica.
Was a huge style icon in the 90s.
Totally. Everyone wanted the Rachel haircut. So we went for a really minimalistic look here. Also, who did minimalism really well was Kate Moss and Winona Ryder. Mm. They were constantly wearing their blacks and their muted colours. And I love this look. This is from F&F, available at Tesco. And it's a really, really chic coat for a really affordable price. And it has that gorgeous oversized look that we went for in the 90s. That really, really comfortable, almost like vintage vibe. You could definitely see Rachel or Phoebe in this coat. And then underneath, she's wearing just a really simple black dress. And if Yumiko turns around, has this beautiful bow detail at the top. The 90s was all about wearability. It wasn't so much fast fashion, so everything was almost quite neutral tones. You'd definitely be able to wear this to so many different occasions, and you'd definitely get a lot of wear out of that.
You were definitely mixing and matching in the 90s.
Totally,
you weren't buying, you were buying one piece and throwing accessories
so
or
much.
Different bits and bobs.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then the jewellery again, all is from Betty and Biddy. The hoops and the chains and all the gold was so in, and all the Versace and the Chanels and all the runways. So I decided to bling up the more simple, minimal look with some sunglasses and some some bling from there from Betty and Biddy. And we just layered it up because it was just so extra. Anything goes. It, 90s, you could play with fashion and you could have so much fun. And it was just such a kind of like revival in regards, it was almost like a performance piece, fashion.
So moving to a bit of glam grunge lately for Christy Turlington, who would have been the icon. You know,
yes.
You've got the big bomber jacket, the jeans, the slouchy jeans.
Well, this was very kind of music inspired.
Yeah.
The likes of Blur and Oasis and all that kind of grungy Nirvana and bands like that. Come As You Are was Nirvana's main song, and it was a very pared down look. It was Come As You Are.
It did start that kind of like that chill, slouchy movement of a baggy t-shirt or a worn t-shirt and a pair of jeans with a kicker.
Totally. And I had to bring back the bucket hat.
Yeah.
We are seeing bucket hats everywhere at the moment, and it's so fun. This full look is from Pamela Scott in stores nationwide and online at pamelascott.com. And I am one for the bucket hat. It is such a fun look. It's very youthful, and it brings me back to my youth, back to my teenage years. And then underneath the cardigan, again, all the cast of Friends. Everybody had a cardigan. It seemed to just be like such a great layering piece over a white tee. And then this gorgeous quilted bomber style jacket. It's actually a long length, so really, really practical, really comfy, and kind of a modern take on that kind of Parker, like slouchy
and
bomber
jacket
style.
And it's not too long length, you know, for different size ranges.
Yeah, you could definitely, I could see lots of people wearing it. It does go into an XL, so it's a really gorgeous piece to have in your wardrobe this summer, or winter, sorry. Then we're on to the like slouchy jeans. I think you guys did a segment on jeans yesterday.
I did.
The death of the skinny jean, I'm all for it. And I love the baggy look. It's so retro, it's so cool, and it's definitely giving me Oasis vibes. Again, a really, really comfortable look. You can swap out your joggers, still look a little kind of like you've made an effort with these gorgeous denim, and they are, the make of those is salsa. They're a really nice stretch. Then we're gonna go on to the jewelry again from Betty and Biddy. We're seeing the chunky hoops. They are actually quite, they were brought over by the pirates, so they were then recreated by all these kind of pop and punk superstars, and now they're in our stores and we can wear them ourselves. But it was a really fun era of just kind of taking inspiration from all the different histories and bringing it into fashion in the 90s.
Yeah, the grunge definitely gave us a lot of inspiration.
I loved it.
For our last inspirational look, this is iconic. Julia Roberts as
Julia
Vivian in Pretty
Roberts.
Woman. We've got some polka dots there. Like this,
absolutely
this was
iconic
movie. Polka dots.
Totally. So this was a 1990 movie, and it was the end of the 80s, and it was now into the chic kind of fashion revival, and then the supermodels and on the catwalk with Gianni Versace started. But Pretty Woman was a really pivotal moment in fashion, where we saw her in all of these chic clothes and polka dots, and that polka dot dress was so iconic. And then Princess Diana absolutely adored polka dots. So polka dots were absolutely everywhere in the 90s. This look is from Fee & Co Boutique in stores nationwide and online at feeandcoboutique.com. They have a store in Swords Pavilion and Portmarnock. It's such a gorgeous piece. Again, you can wear everything here separately, like the gorgeous blazer. We added a pop of pink.
I love what you've
here.
Done with the pop of pink. That's it. That's such a nice style, especially with the white. And then, is it a navy in the polka dot?
It's actually a black, but it does look like kind of a light black because there are little mini polka dots running
through
it as well.
That's what's giving me the
brand of that dress is Goa. It's made beautifully and it's so, so flattering. Then we have added a little headband as well, just to bejewel her. Very Versace, and then again all of the earrings and layered up pieces to just really bling out the look.
And then the blazer, again, a really great piece that you wear over and over again and just really complements the whole look. So chic, and I think it would be so beautiful for so many different occasions.
Absolutely, absolutely. Roz, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. That
so
was
we've gone glam grunge, yeah. We've had polka dots, we've had so much. Ah, we missed the 90s.
We're inspired.
We missed the 90s.
I just need the tearaways. Couldn't find them.
After the break, we'll be chatting about the new season of Strictly in our big TV preview. We'll see you then. Welcome back. We're taken to the tellies now, and there's one obvious standout in next week's programming. One event that just about everyone is talking about, Strictly.
Come on, Killian. Joining us now on the couch with all the latest TV news and gossip. He's a fellow who loves telly so much, he won't even fast forward through the ads. That's really something.
Love the ads. The ads are one of my favourite parts of the TV.
I'm sure.
There's an ad on the TV at the moment for, I think it's for Ribena. It's the most bizarre. It's a fella trying to parallel park and then loads of cats start judging him. Basically, you'd wonder what happens in the agency where they sit down and go, this is a good idea. But yeah, it went to air, and the next time you see it, you'll spot it and go, that's the craziest ad ever. Anyway, let's get on to the TV shows.
And just a point of note, I think it's a brilliant ad. I think it's fantastic. I love,
oh, is this a counter?
And okay. Those people that make the ads and pay for the ads, I think they're doing fantastic work.
I love cats.
I love ads. The ads are my favourite thing as well, because they pay our wages. Let's have a look at telly this week, looking ahead, and we'll start. Well, there's a lot of excitement about this. Disney Plus had a big day, their Disney Plus day, an invented day, really, for announcing stuff.
Basically,
and
yeah.
And this was part of it.
So this, again, is Disney recouping their initial investment in buying Star Wars. They spent about $4 billion, including stocks. I think it works out actually to nearly $10 billion when they acquired the rights to the Star Wars world. And at the time, everyone was like, sorry, for a few movies, that's crazy. But they obviously had this plan in mind. They knew streaming was coming down the line. They knew they had the ability to create all these shows. And you look at the spin-offs they've already had, The Mandalorian. There's been four or five different animated and real-life spin-offs. And then, of course, there's the theme parks that they have in there. Uh-huh. So they have well recouped their $10 million investment.
And this is Andor.
Andor.
Now, Andor is the moon. If yes. I'm not mistaken.
Andor's moon, yeah. Andor, this is a prequel. Andor is a character. This is a prequel set about 5 years before Rogue One, which was one of the most popular of the newer Star Wars movies.
I really
movies.
Liked that one, yeah.
Really good.
It's kind of like a middle plot between what happened. How did they get the plans of the Death Star was the gist of it.
Yeah.
And so, a lot of these characters didn't show up in other films. It was self-contained. It was like a bubble story.
And much like this, they've already commissioned the second series, and the director behind it was able to go into this knowing it's two 12-episode series, and because they knew that, it's not going to run for series after series,
right.
They were able to put a, how do I word this without spoiling it too much? They can wrap everything up with a nice bow at the end.
Right.
They can contain the story.
They can contain the story within these two seasons so that it's not this, like, Lost, where it goes season after season after season and there's no real end in sight. This, from the get-go, they can already put story arcs in place that will come to a natural close
because
before the end.
Because they need to fit the other...
Because they have to fit it in because, of course, this two series happens before Rogue One, so they can't have stuff that bleeds into Rogue One without it affecting the greater world.
Gotcha.
So there are certain things that will come to a natural end in these two series. But as a producer, as a director, to be able to come into something knowing it's just two series so that you can really work on those story arcs and make them make sense instead of, you know, sometimes they release a season, it goes really well, and then it's like, right, now you've got to drag that out for four seasons.
Right.
And they're kind of diluting the storylines, whereas this way, they
it's
can
all
just...
Containing
I love the
Mandalorian. Itself.
They're still in Skarsgård as well. It looks absolutely fantastic. And it's happening next during the Wednesday. It's the first stream.
Yeah, so the first season is, of course, 12 episodes, and the first three episodes are going to drop on Wednesday. And then, like a lot of the streamers, they're ditching the binge drop. So it's going to be weekly from that point on.
I kind of like that now. I kind of like that. So that's Disney Plus. Moving to BBC One. This Friday. Now, obviously, there's been, you know, the talk that it should have happened on Saturday, but due to the Queen's passing in the morning.
Sorry, what?
The
apparently there's a big funeral over in the UK. Yeah, did you not hear about this?
No,
You're yeah. so bold. Strictly Come Dancing is hitting Friday. And yeah, this is so the pre-recorded show that's already been done.
So they do, they have this pre-rec show, right, which is the big launch introductory show. So that's in the can, that's ready to go, and it was meant to air this weekend on Friday. But obviously with all of the TV networks in the UK adjusting their schedules, they said it's probably in best taste to push it out for a week. So they're going to push it out till next week, but then the live show is going to kick in. And look, this is just doing what it does best. It also kind of signifies the run-up to Christmas, which yeah. I know some people, is like a bittersweet thing. As much as they love Strictly, it's like, oh, this is it now. You're getting the colder evenings, you're getting the kind of the longer, darker nights. But there's a lot to be said for that as well, because you snuggle up on the sofa and you can watch a series like this week after week. The thing about it is, people always have a pop of the level of celebrity. Celebrity is relative to some people.
Like, actually, it doesn't matter. It's not about the level. Yeah, of course, you're right. It's not about the level of celebrity at all. It's just people, it's different characters that you can get invested in.
Yeah,
really different storyboards.
We just take their word for it that they're famous.
Enjoy yeah, and then watch them.
Yeah.
Watch them dancing.
I think the guy from the Ribena ad is going to be in next season.
No, the guy who wrote the Ribena ad. Yeah, yeah. The genius behind the Ribena ad.
So, are you penning a deal in the background with Ribena?
Look, this, I tell you what, call me. I'll paint my face purple. Ridley is going to be on Virgin Media One. This is a great series, actually. Yeah, he's... yeah, tell us about it.
So, based on... There's a lot of people in the background behind this who are the people behind the likes of...
Line of Duty,
Blood, Midsommar Murders, Casualty. Adrian Dunbar takes the leading role as this retired detective. Now, I know this is going to sound like a trope that we've seen time and time again. A retired detective who is drawn back out of retirement because the young detective who is meant to take over their cases needs his expertise. So he finds himself, episode after episode, coming back out of retirement again, almost like Conor McGregor in and out of retirement, but he's back to solve a crime. And there are 4 2-hour-long episodes. So each of these are like feature-length movies. Whoa. Look at them almost more like a 4-movie series. And over the course of the 2 hours, Adrian Dunbar's character, Ridley, comes back out of retirement and they will hope to try and solve. Yeah. So it's a big whodunit. There's going to be lots of who do you think it is. There's leaving breadcrumbs down different trails, and then you as a viewer have your suspicions then in the last 10 minutes.
Feels very Wallander-ish, this one, for me.
Yes, yeah that
the
kind
big,
of...
long... episodes and
the fact
drama.
That they don't have to tie it up in 30 minutes. They can let those storylines breathe a little bit longer.
It's great. Yeah.
So that's Virgin Media One this week.
And of course, so if you like the first episode on Friday and you can't wait till next week, the whole series will drop on Virgin Media Player Friday night.
If you're greedy like
so,
me,
yeah,
if I
you
have
wanna,
to.
If you want to stay up all night going, just one more episode yeah. and then all of a sudden it's 4 a.m, you can do that. On Virgin
For the bingers, where did my time go? The Thai cave rescue has in itself... doesn't even need to be dramatized.
It's been told. This story has been told and adapted a number of times already, generally through documentaries. This is the first time I've really seen a really good drama adaptation of it. This is a multi-episode series, and it tells the story of this young team of footballers who went to spend the day with their coach exploring these caves. This flash storm came in, and the rain rose so quickly it trapped these kids in the caves. They were there for days. The rescue mission took over 10,000 people, more than 100 divers, about 100 government agencies, different government agencies. They had to try and pump water out. That was one of the plans. They pumped more than 1 billion litres of water out of the caves. That's billion with a B. There was 700 diving cylinders of air. And this isn't a big spoiler, but the main concern was that because the rainfall came in, the dive to get to where the team were was something that only really experienced divers could actually do. So it wasn't about getting the divers to them. They found some specialist divers who could do that. It was getting the boys out with them panicking, freaking out. So they actually sedated the kids so that they could safely transport them back to the group. It's an incredible story, and this is filmed on location in Thailand with a lot of local crew. You're seeing subtitles, it's not all right. subtitled. There is, you know, where it's authentically subtitled, so when there's two people from Thailand talking to each other, they're going to speak in their native tongue.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But then there are English-speaking characters who are in there speaking in their native tongue, so it is...
Is it true to form as to what happened?
Very much
they've
so.
Kept very much to the
yeah,
story?
Yeah, because, I mean, as Ray said, you don't need to add any drama to this. This already is so filled with drama, emotion. It's got kind of everything you need is a storyline, and the fact that this is all based on true events is just even more startling.
Did you did Colin Farrell do a version of it as well? Did you see any of that?
I didn't see any of that.
And lastly, Paramount Plus, Savage River.
Yes. This looks great. This, again, very quickly, is a girl who spent about a decade in prison. She was accused, she was committed of manslaughter. So she gets out, she moves back to her small town in Australia, and then she's trying to start her life again. But of course, the small town haven't moved on from the tragedy that happened a decade earlier. And within days of her coming out of prison and coming back to her small town, surprise, surprise, a murder happens.
That's just bad luck. That is just bad luck.
So it ends up the cops are obviously looking at her. She knows she's innocent of this, so she starts to dig. And then the more she digs, she unearths a whole heap of new
story
based. I'm trying to dance around the spoilers. It's difficult. But this
they
looks
sedate
like
the children anyway.
They didn't need to sedate the children in this one. No, this this looks incredible. This is a great, great series on Paramount Plus.
On Paramount Plus, Savage River.
Yep.
I love some. We were talking earlier on about the things you add to your list, add to your watch list to watch.
Yeah,
there's a few there now.
There's a few there you can fill up now, and that's the thing. You can add to your watch list on the various platforms now,
yeah,
and then
we'll do it.
On those cold winter nights.
Killian, thanks a million, man.
Killian, thank you very much.
Earlier on, we cooked up some chicken and mushroom linguine. I'm covered in it, actually. Here's how we did it.
Fry the onion over a low heat for 10 minutes, then add the garlic and white wine. Fry the pancetta and mushrooms. Add the butter and the flour and stir for 3 to 5 minutes. Whisk in your chicken stock. When it starts to thicken, add the cream. Mix the fried onion, garlic and mushrooms on the pan with your cooked chicken. Cook your pasta and toss it into your creamy sauce. Season with black pepper, top with the parsley and some grated Parmesan, and serve with garlic bread.
Oh yeah, I'll go again. Might have that tonight actually. Looks lovely, doesn't it? Looks lovely on the telly. Coming up tomorrow, as Britain's Queen Elizabeth II is laid to rest, we'll be crossing live to London ahead of the funeral service.
And he's one of the country's most prolific authors. We'll be catching up with John Boyne about his follow-up to The Boy in the Striped Pyjamas.
Plus, with warnings of winter power cuts, we check out energy-saving gadgets.
All that plus news, sport and weather you'll be waking up to. Join Tommy, Mirren and Alan tomorrow live from 7. Now, on texts, Linguine, Shauna says, Lizzie's gift for taking ordinary dishes and making them look incredible is something to behold. The linguine looks great. Well, from
butter.
My and his top, it was absolutely beautiful.
Yeah, I'd be sucking the top dry once, because there's still a little bit of leftovers by the time I get in the door.
On the Garth Brooks situation, Imogen says, saw Garth twice, best gig in years.
Yeah.
So listen,
He's a showman. He's coming back then. He'll be doing your local GAA hall the next time he comes, hopefully next year. Have a lovely rest of your Sunday. We'll see you next
week. Enjoy your week. Have a good one.